NPR and actually radio in general has led the way in some of the storytelling innovations we've been seeing. And you don't think of it as an avant-garde medium. So tell us a little bit about your work and what you've been doing to lead the way on that.
Sure. And thank you. That's very kind of you. And thank you for organizing this panel. One thing that I came to NPR thinking about was just this notion. When they called me in the first place to try and hire me, they were looking for somebody who was a little bit more startup-minded, because NPR is an organization that had been around for 40 years. And they wanted to start a startup within NPR, so a new vertical. And one of the things that I brought over was this context layer over stump speeches that I created actually at the Texas Tribune. Do you want me to show it first and then we can talk
a little bit about it?
Okay.
Medicaid, that's the health care program for the poor in this country. I take that program and the dollars in it and send it back to Iowa for the people of Iowa, and let the governor here and the legislature here craft your own Medicaid program to care for your own poor in the way you think is best. Because, by the way, being poor in Iowa is different than being poor in New York or Mississippi or Montana. Craft a program that works for the people in Iowa. And by the way, if we do that, if we give Iowans their Medicaid dollars and grow them every year by the CPI plus 1%, the savings that accrues to the federal budget is $100 billion a year.
Okay.
Real money.
Don't you miss him? Talk about that.
So the idea for this, it was inspired, of course, by VH1's pop-up video, which I really enjoyed growing up. And what I like about it is the same reason I really like footnotes in reading, which is you're reading along and then there's an asterisk or a footnote and you go, but you have to interrupt your reading in order to get that context layer. And what video and what this sort of medium frees us to do is actually let you see the footnote, let you get that context in real time. This was compelling for me because I covered Texas politics for many years, and when you're on the trail, you watch the same stump speech over and over and over. That becomes uninteresting. The sort of body of the speech sort of just becomes white noise in your mind. But when you're with the reporters on the trail who have seen that speech over and over again, it's actually interesting what sort of commentary they make, right? Because they've seen it so many times that they're like, yeah, you know, Mitt Romney, for instance, always made this point about the Navy being inefficient because we didn't build as many ships. We used to build a lot of ships and now we make fewer ships. But then reporters would be like, yeah, but we shouldn't be building that many ships because ships should be better, you know? And so what if we had a way to actually have that sort of wry commentary, fact-checking, actually on the layer of media? And so that was kind of how this was born. This project in and of itself is not that impressive, but the reason why I wanted to talk about it is because it's the product of a certain kind of newsroom orientation, a certain kind of culture that I think we really need to be fighting for, and that's that of a startup. The notion that you can kind of throw out your old processes, that you can be risk-taking, that you can be more ruthless about saying, this doesn't work, we should do it a different way. I think that this is kind of how Snowfall was born, too. Pop-up Politics was born at a startup where I had all this time to experiment and a lot of time to take risks because we didn't have an audience. There was no consequence for doing so. Now, I don't know if now that I'm sort of heads down and in the weekly, daily news cycle, whether I could just say, you know what, I'm going to take 3 or 4 weeks to just invent a new story form. That would be very challenging. But it speaks to kind of this larger point, which is that at NPR, we talk a lot about trying to be both a factory and a lab. So newsrooms have become largely operational in a lot of ways, right? We have certain editorial structures, we have processes, they're kind of codified. We meet at certain times of the day, we have certain deadlines that we have to meet, we have certain production goals that we have to meet. That's operational, that's sort of the factory side of news. And that's important because our users, our audience, count on us to deliver that product. But at the same time, the lab is also really important. That startup-y culture, that place where we can fail fast, that place where we can challenge what we're doing. And I think one of the big questions for us now as storytellers, as journalists, and as and as organizations, is how to get the lab side of the organization to better infiltrate the upper management and upper sort of decision makers in the factory side. We haven't quite figured that out yet. You know, at NPR, we started Serendipity Days, which is like Google 20% time. Are you all familiar with Google 20% time? So for those of you who aren't, Google employees get to have get to take 20% of their time to do a project that they're passionate about that somehow can redound well for the company, right? But it doesn't really have to be related to their work or whatever they're tasked with. And they end up coming up with great things that have, do you guys have good examples of what serendipity or what 20% time has actually created? There's actually great things that we, Google News is 20% time. Yeah, there's all sorts of great products of 20% time. So we started the same thing. We started Serendipity Days. And Serendipity Days have actually sprung up all these great ideas, but it's only happened in digital media, which is the product place, and not digital news, which is actually the factory side of coming up with the product. And there are radio folks who didn't even know about Serendipity Days. And so we're still working on how to kind of get the lab and the factory to better meld.